First seen in the 1920s, no one cared much about the plot. People came to see Rudolph Valentino's sultry, sexy performance in another desert chic drama testing the virtue of an innocent girl. In the story, virtue will eventually triumph. But meanwhile, Valentino looks at the girl with cold scorn and hot eyes. His intentions are clear. She pleads. But he's arrogant, handsome, strong, relentless. Many women wondered if they could have resisted as fervently as this innocent heroine. They watched with bated breath. When sex was rarely mentioned and never in mixed company, the movies of Rudolph Valentino excited millions. Many women in the audience fainted, watching the approach of their lover. And sometimes Valentino was a French nobleman from a gallant age of the past. In the 20s, men didn't show obvious sexual interest in women, unless they were cads, or heroes from a different time or place. Today, we smile at that quaint attitude, but the sexual motivation we're concerned with is strongly influenced by social attitudes. In addition, attitudes are important to understand because they influence scientific research as well as sexual practices. The attitudes of the 20s made research on sexual motivation difficult. Attitudes towards sex roles have changed a lot over the centuries, from Adam and Eve to Romeo and Juliet, through other times and cultures. Sex roles have changed as much as society's view of an attractive, shapely woman. Woman's role has been concubine, earth mother, creature of comfort. Mistress, girl next door, goddess, saint, and sex pot. Man has been stereotyped too. His roles have included mighty father, wise teacher, Superman. It's hard to measure up. Men and women have looked at each other differently in different times. As human beings, we adjust our behavior to the times we live in. The Victorian era, for example, had a great influence on attitudes towards sex, both for men and women. A woman was mother, homemaker, cook. Father was provider, and provided for large families, with very good manners. A woman was gracious, proud to be wife and mother, actually almost the only suitable occupation for a lady. Mother was always a lady. And ladies were supposed to have children, but not enjoy sex. In fact, in polite circles, no one even mentioned sex. At the turn of the century, after Victoria's death, some people reacted to the years of inhibition with relief. Men and women began to relax a little during the reign of Victoria's son, Edward. They were more open with each other, even free to ride in a horseless carriage, more or less alone. But a woman was still her husband's property. Few people practiced birth control or had abortions. Illegitimate birth was still scandalous. And the new motion picture industry caused an uproar with sexy scenes like this. But winds of change were blowing. Women were on the march, not just for votes, but for the right to be treated as equal human beings. It was in this freer atmosphere that an American psychologist, John Watson, decided to study human sexual behavior scientifically. Scientific method required studying male and female sexual response in the laboratory, which had never been attempted before. Watson took measurements of physiological changes during intercourse. His subjects were his female assistant and himself. But possibly he spent too much time collecting data. At any rate, his wife divorced him, and the public was outraged at the story. Watson's wife also confiscated all his experimental data. But even if she hadn't, his academic career had ended. Times and attitudes had changed, but not that much. And why all this fuss? Watson was simply studying sexual responses, and sex is a basic physiological process. Or at least it's that basic for most animals. The biological sex drive has always existed, stated with show and shape in some animals. And in others, simply as a perpetuation of the species. Call it primitive, but in lower animals, being sexy is strictly a matter of chemicals. These special male and female chemicals, called hormones, control the sex drive. The drive goes in cycles, and it's as predictable as the tides. When her special sex hormones make the female fertile, the male is attracted to her. That seems to please these Western grebes. Then again, when the female is not fertile, she's not interested in mating. And the male could care less. That's true for most animals. What about these young humans? What part do hormones play in their sexual motivation? Well, hormones don't have absolute control over the sex drive in humans, but they do affect it. For example, studies show that women have more interest in sexual activity when they're ovulating than at other times of the monthly cycle. They stimulate themselves sexually, fantasize more about sex, and make amorous overtures to their partners. Sex hormones affect all of us even before we're born. Even in the womb, the development of male-female characteristics is the result of male-female sex hormones. As we grow, hormones play a big part in our sexuality. The glands in our bodies produce hormones which cause changes. Obvious changes occur during adolescence. Girls grow hair under the arms and around the vagina. Boys grow hair on the face and chest as well. Girls' breasts develop, and their body lines become softer and less angular. Boys' bodies become manly, and their voices get deeper. These changes are simple human biology. The biology of sex is basic to all animals, people as well as birds. Although hormones affect our sexuality, that's only part of human sexual motivation and behavior. We're not just simple biological creatures. We're complex. And so is our sexual motivation. Even our dreams and fantasies affect it. Fantasy can be a delightful spur, but it's never so important to motivation as the reality of the times. War has been a bitter reality of the 20th century. We've known mass destruction and the devastation of aerial bombing. After the First World War, we knew depression, and then war again. Wars uproot people. They turn days into nightmares. They overturn beliefs and traditions. And the 20th century wars took many Americans far away from home, to Europe and to remote islands of the Pacific. Whether they were soldiers or sailors or airmen, they met different kinds of people, people with cultures that seemed strange at first. In these faraway lands with unfamiliar customs and under the stress of war, sexual attitudes changed. At home, the lives of American women changed too. They waited and worked. During World War II, American women worked in factories, a new experience for many of them. It helped them to see themselves as more than mothers and homemakers. And when men came home from war, they saw the difference. Women were at home in the factories. Times had changed. Sexual attitudes were more relaxed, open. Men and women worked together, often at the same jobs. They played together more freely. And they could even talk about sex. People were shedding many pre-war restrictions on behavior. In this more open atmosphere, one scientist had great success studying human sexuality. Alfred Kinsey and his associates asked thousands of people to talk about their sex lives. And they did. The results were several books of information on sex practices and attitudes. Information from volunteers who answered hundreds of questions. Their answers added up to a most important mass of material, if volunteers were honest and objective. But there may have been some who tried too hard to make their answers seem interesting and unusual. Others may have held back information that made them feel ashamed. But most of the volunteers were probably as honest as they were able to be. And readers who had thought their own sex lives might be abnormal or evil sighed with relief. Kinsey's reports told them they were very much like everyone else. But if Kinsey reassured them, he shocked them too. At that time, it was shocking to learn that 4% of the men and 2% of the women interviewed said that they were predominantly homosexual. Kinsey also found that sexual behavior varied with social class. For example, professional men did more kissing and embracing than blue-collar workers, but blue-collar workers had intercourse more frequently than white-collar men. Many women told Kinsey that individual or mutual sexual arousal led to orgasm more often than intercourse did. The Kinsey reports shocked many people in the 1950s, but they opened the way for the scientific study of sexuality by doctors, psychologists, and many other researchers. Two of these researchers collaborated on a new type of study. They were William Masters, a gynecologist, and Virginia Johnson, a psychologist. They reported their research findings on sexual behavior in the 60s and 70s. Masters and Johnson's research differed from Kinsey's because they studied men and women volunteers in a laboratory. Times had changed since Kinsey started his research. For one thing, the Kinsey books had been widely read. Birth control pills had come on the market, and men and women were beginning to approach sex and each other more as equals. In their laboratory, Masters and Johnson observed sexual responses. What did they find out? Well, for one thing, they confirmed Kinsey's findings about the female orgasm. For a woman, orgasm is the same physiologically, no matter what part of her body is stimulated. Another discovery Masters and Johnson made in the lab was that the stages of sexual arousal are the same physiologically for both men and women. Masters and Johnson learned this by measuring sexual responses of their volunteer subjects, just as John Watson had done almost 50 years before. But their findings were published, not confiscated. What Masters and Johnson learned in the lab is now public and well known. People today, men and women, have a new understanding of what gives them sexual pleasure, and they have a new desire to give and to receive pleasure as part of sexual activity. For many men and women today, the chief motivation for sexual activity is pleasure. But is this pleasure in touching, feeling, or is it all in our minds? We don't know. In the lab, we're still learning more about the physiology of sexual arousal. But we also know that our attitudes are part of our sexual motivation. Today's attitudes are the result of slow changes. One of the unofficial records of these changes is found in old movies. Unless they're Valentino costume pictures, movies reflect the attitudes of their time. In the early part of this century, girls were prim and proper. But in this scene, Lillian Gish played a daring young woman. She threw herself at her man with a peck on the cheek. Men weren't accustomed to such behavior from nice girls. A respectable man like William S. Hart wouldn't expect it even of his fiancée, even when he goes off to the wars. He wants a goodbye kiss. But manly reserve wins over passion, and he kisses her sleeve. But the First World War toppled some barriers. Kisses could be passionate with French girls. And from then on, there could be a kind of playful sexuality between a nice girl and the boy next door. To say nothing of the other boy next door. This scene, of course, was not to be taken seriously. It was comedy. But the kisses were allowed to grow in intensity until they weren't funny anymore. And eventually, the movies were able to show Mae West in an open sexual invitation.
I'll screw up some time soon.
Attitudes towards sex were clearly changing. It was even possible in the movie Frankenstein's Bride to show the robot with a strong, recognizably human sexual drive. Probably the human quality of Frankenstein's sexual advances added to the terror, not only of his bride, but of audiences. Mm-hmm. But no one questioned the idea that human responses could be manufactured in a laboratory creature. After all, it was science fiction. But the possibility of a manufactured sexual response is no longer science fiction. Until recently, scientists had been unable to locate a specific area of pleasure stimulation in the brain. Pleasure, they reasoned, was simply the absence of pain. But new research indicates that the sensation of pleasure exists by itself. In the early 1950s, psychologists James Olds and Peter Milner discovered specific areas of the brain that experience pleasure. Another researcher, Dr. Robert Heath, explained some of this work.
And we began looking specifically to see if there was any part of the brain which might have to do with the expression of feelings, the expression of emotion, and level of awareness. Now, in order to get at this question, in order to explore it, we had to develop new techniques, and this involved the development of techniques for implanting electrodes into these precise regions deep in the brain so that we could sample the activity that was going on.
Experiments involve people and animals. The experiments are painless. A specific area of the brain receives an electric charge. The switch controlling the charge is a lever inside the cage. Pressing the lever produces a pleasant feeling for the cat. And the cat quickly learns to continue pressing the lever. The cat even prefers this pleasure to food. How does electric stimulation of the brain feel? We're not sure. We think it feels good. Certainly, we know that specific areas of the brain feel different types of pleasure. Some feel sexual pleasure.
When you have your choice there, what one do you like to push?
I like to push this one, yeah.
What's that do?
That gives me a very good feeling.
Advertisers, as well as scientists, know that the sensation of feeling good exists. It motivates people in the lab to push buttons, and people on the streets to buy goods.
I like it. She liked it. And if you're a man like me, you like it too.
A product of Rapid Foam Shave Cream Company, Rapid Foam, Minnesota.
Sexual motivation sells shaving cream. Do you want to buy that shaving cream? Or do you want the blonde? Or the intelligent fellow on the left? In Watson's day, sex was a temptation that couldn't be spoken aloud. Now it beckons us from billboards, all of us. Scientists like Masters and Johnson do not live only in the laboratory. Nor did Kinsey or Watson. The world of their time affects scientists as individuals and also helps shape the goals and acceptance of their research. For them, as for the rest of us, advertisements and comic books are part of the world. These ads seem to give free expression to our tastes and desires. Victorians would say, too free. We say the Victorians were too inhibited. Maybe our attitudes swing on a pendulum. If the Victorians were at one end, where is the other? It's a temptation for most of us to think that we have the answers, or we're on the brink of discovering them. But in sexual behavior, as in all areas of human experience, we go through stages, from birth to adolescence and beyond. As adults, our sexual motivation is shaped by hormones and by a pleasure center in our brain. But it's also shaped by all the variables of life in a family and in a society. Sexual motivation is both uniquely individual and part of the complex structure of human behavior and society.